have Udit Bhatia with us. I should say Dr. Udit Bhatia. And he is an environmentalist in Boston. Before that, in India, he was a civil engineer. So we'll be having an interactive talk about climate change that is happening around us all over the world. It's a global issue today. Mm-hmm. So to begin with, Udit, you became a civil engineer in India, and you also joined, I think, industry or some corporation in India.
Yeah.
What made you go into the field of environment? Mm-hmm.
So when I was doing my undergrad as a civil engineer, we are taught a lot of codal provisions that how you should design your buildings, how you should design your structures. And most of those design standards, they are based on historical data, what has already happened. However, when I was doing my undergraduation, I came across this fascinating field of climate change, which talked about like how hazards are evolving in changing climate, how precipitation extremes are growing more intense, how wind extremes are growing more intense. So that made me think that our current codal provisions on which all design standards for our drainage, roads, infrastructures, and structural systems are based, are they sufficient to cater events that are going to happen in next 100 years or next 200 years? That made me think, isn't there a scope of research or asking these questions to a scientific community? How prepared are we to mitigate and adapt for these events? And that made me think, like, it's time to change the course and go for higher education instead of continuing in the industry. And I think that it proved to be a right decision, because I learned a lot, I grew a lot in terms of my understanding about all these things.
Before moving to more serious questions, it's a typical problem in India in understanding who is an environmentalist.
So according to me, anybody who cares about an environment is an environmentalist. It's again a broad term. I would say it's a cliche that you can say that somebody who is planting trees on one particular day is an environmentalist. However, if he or she makes no effort towards an environment, to think about the environment on a normal day, I would not say that he is an environmentalist by heart. So an environmentalist can be a social worker, a media person who is bringing out voices and spreading it to common people who want to know about these fields, generally misinformed and really don't know that what these environmental changes entail. It could be scientists and research scholars like us, because all we do is like try to develop new methodologies to inform science, engineering and policy makers that what is need to be done. However, scientific community alone is not enough to translate those researches to implementation, and that's where we seek our politicians and engineers to be environmentalists. So it's a broad term, and everybody who cares about the environment from heart could be classified as an environmentalist.
So what exactly is your research in the field of environment?
As you mentioned that my undergrad was in civil engineering, so I'm still an engineer, and my research is in the field of interdisciplinary engineering. And by interdisciplinarity, we mean that we try to bring science and engineering together so that we can prepare our infrastructure systems to stand the evolving hazards. For example, my first research paper that came out during my duration of study was making Indian Railways network more resilient. As we know, Indian Railways is world's largest network in terms of number of people it transports every day. However, events like tsunami of 2004, power blackout of 2012 played havoc on this particular network. And a small failure in this large network can propagate through entire system and can bring this particular system to standstill. So we started investigating that how hazards are changing, what kind of hazards can impact systems like Indian Railways, US National Air Transportation System, Global Air Transportation System, And once these systems are disrupted, what is the best way to recover these systems? One of the research that I did was applied to New York's mass transit system, and we realized that if we change the recovery sequences after some particular hazards, we could save a few million dollars within a scope of 2 days, because now we are going towards the best solution to restore these systems rather than doing a random recovery that generally happens in business as usual scenarios.
It's interesting to know whatever you are telling now, mm-hmm. but you moved from a core engineering subject like civil engineering, we have electrical and all that.
Yes.
These are new fields like environmental engineering, then you have nanotechnology,
yes.
then genetic engineering, then
yes.
stem cells and all that. Do you see a convergence between all these new technologies for the new world challenges?
Yeah, of course. So as you are mentioning about new technologies, I'll take a little bit of divergence and I'll talk about a more interesting technology that is coming into existence is artificial intelligence. All of us know that we use our phones like Google and Apple and talk to Google Voice and Siri, and they help us take the best decision at a given time whenever you ask them a question. So what we did, we adapted this particular technology to solve some of the climate problems, and we use artificial intelligence, machine learning algorithms to address some of the burning issues in climate change. That is, as you know, that climate is more of a global phenomena, but what it means for regions. So we use machine learning algorithms to identify what these global changes mean for a small region, for small city. Similarly, as you mentioned about biotechnology, stem cells, they have a much bigger role to play because we are in a resource scarce environment. And this resource scarcity is because of our population is increasing. The way we are living our lives, it has become more of a resource intensive exercise if you compare with a decade or two decades back. So these technologies help us grow crops which require less water, which are more immune to disease. And that helps us use all these things for a better good. You mentioned about nanotechnology. Nanotechnology has done wonders to make harnessing solar energy more cost effective. If you think about a decade or 20 years back, no one ever thought that they would be able to install solar panels on roads at their homes. But thanks to technologies like nanotechnology, which has revolutionized the cost effectiveness of all these technologies.
It is often said, especially in this part of the world, that when the Industrial Revolution came up, say 100 years ago,
yes.
the big countries like USA and the EU, the European
yeah.
countries, they had a free hand in exploiting the resources and all that.
Yeah.
And that time machines were not efficient at all.
Mm-hmm.
And now because the regulatory systems are in place and developing countries like India and China,
yeah.
do we have rather a tough time compared to what they had done during their industrial progress?
So I would say that yes, many of these developing nations, they often face this challenge, and many developed nations question these countries at international summits that you have to check your ways, because 100 years before today, no one ever thought that this problem of climate change would become such a big deal for entire humanity. What we have done to our Mother Earth in past 100 years, I think it has never happened in the Earth's history, which is guided by humans. So when these industrialization started, we had no regularization, no regulation, because now problem has grown so much, every country is concerned. And yes, I would say that now developing nations are at receiving hands from developed nations that you have to check your ways. And the field of science is still evolving. Understanding is not there. Perfect understanding of climate change, what are the causes, are not there. And that's where there is this entire debate. And it's always said, like, you should learn from the mistakes that you have already done in history. So it should not be an excuse for either for developed nation or developing nation that you have done your part and let us emit. So that should not be an excuse, because that would be repeating your own mistakes.
So it is now a global responsibility. Everyone has to be responsible toward environment and climate change.
Yes, and easier said than done. It requires a much bigger cooperation at national, international level. consensus among nations, consensus among continents. So it's a big problem. I'm not saying that solutions exist, but and good thing is the optimistic side is that many countries in this world now care about what is happening to our earth, and they are taking steps in these directions. So I would not be that much pessimistic about future.
Yes,
and say that
even
things may
I agree
be
with you. Even citizens are also getting aware
exactly.
day by day that yes, we have to care for the environment. It's not.
Yeah.
Environment is for us, and it's not anyone's personal domain.
Yes.
And carbon emissions play a major role in climate change. Can increasing emissions accelerate the climate change?
Of course. So if you talk about climate change, one of the biggest contributors of this global warming is greenhouse effect. As many of us are familiar with this term, like if waves enter a glass room, and they cannot leave with the same frequency they enter, and that's why your cars are warmer in summers when they are standing outside. Now extend this car to entire globe, and if you are adding more and more emissions, you would be trapping more and more heat in Earth's system. Radiations would not be able to escape the Earth's atmosphere, and that would contribute towards increased temperatures. Moreover, it's not only carbon dioxide that's responsible. It is methane that is contributed a lot by bovine population. Water vapors are, in fact, one of the are even bigger contributors than many of the greenhouse gases towards this global warming.
Like extensive sowing of rice paddies.
Yeah. So whenever you, I would say when you talk about like growing rice paddies or doing agriculture activities, most of these agriculture activities, they have a negative carbon budget because they help convert the carbon dioxide into oxygen. So going towards more of a green culture is beneficial to the environment, and going towards more of a brown culture, when I talk about brown culture, is going towards more meat intensive dietary habits, that is more of a carbon positive activities.
So I have a few questions which I actually copied from NASA.
Sure.
So I could not understand what actually they mean. Many of viewers may also be at. So one is that what is ocean acidification?
So this is very interesting question, because when we live in inland states like ours, like for example North India, we don't have any ocean, but most of the world, largest population in the world lives along the coast. So they depend on the ocean. So it's a very important question. So when we talk about ocean acidification, most of the oceans, they have, in fact all water bodies, they have tendency to absorb carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. However, after a certain threshold, if they keep on absorbing more and more carbon dioxide, that carbon dioxide reacts with water and it becomes a carbonic acid. So increased level of carbon dioxide in atmosphere results in more of a formation of carbonic acid, as a result of which pH of oceans decrease, it becomes more acidic. And it has tremendous impact on biodiversity. Many of fish and other forms that live in ocean, they get impacted, and it impacts those population who depend entirely for their food on the oceans.
You're right. I've seen in North America, like California, Vancouver,
yeah,
many of the cities and houses are right on the seashore.
Mm-hmm.
And can this rise in ocean level play and havoc with their
Of course. So with all the discussions that are going around climate change and melting of land ice, sea levels are expected to rise, and with more and more population that is moving towards coastal cities, they are becoming more of a vulnerable spots. So imagine a village with a few hundreds getting flooded and a city with a few millions getting flooded. So the impact is instantaneous. You will have more loss of life, more loss of financial assets, and moreover, whenever we talk about losses in life, that is huge. That is a big loss in terms of, you cannot even monetize certain losses, and that's why we have to be extra prepared for some of the non-conventional hazards that have never happened before. And this brings a discussion back to the point, and that is where our codal provisions are not sufficient, because our codal provisions never talk about all these inundations that are going to happen in coastal megacities.
But for the same question, what can be the expected timeline of like sea getting into the city. Is it going to happen very early or maybe?
I would say, like, based on various scientific literature, expected timeline is like next 50 years to next 100 years if the emissions and rate of emissions globally remains unchecked. Then the dreadly future is
so,
not
so
far
it's,
away.
It's
I would
not,
say
it's not really
next,
very long time.
Especially in terms of human years,
you can say
which
it's
is measured in
one or two generations.
Exactly, because human years are measured in terms of billions of years. But right now we are talking a few hundred years or maybe a few decades. So it's a sorry time for us, and we have to be very careful with that.
One question that I find here is, what does climate change have to do with spreading diseases?
When we talk about changing climate, we say that regions that are dry are expected to grow more dry and humid. And these are ideal conditions for many of the mosquitoes breed to grow. So there have been multiple research publications recently which have linked that increase in global warming with increase in mosquito population, especially in tropical countries like Africa, South America, and regions surrounding South America, and countries in South America like Brazil, Argentina, and so on. So, with more population of mosquitoes, you expect that and these are the carriers of disease. The vector-borne disease will intensify, especially in these hot and humid areas. And with expected humidity to grow with higher temperatures, we are preparing ideal breeding ground for these mosquitoes.
You're born and brought up in India, and now you're living in where MIT is, Massachusetts.
Yes.
That's the hub of any technology world over. But don't you feel that for a country like India and other poor countries, this burden is going to be a big burden in terms of funds to be put into containing the threat of climate change?
I would say more than funds, we require more of a holistic approach both from policymakers and engineers, that they identify this particular problem. Sometimes fixes are so small, but the problem is so big, and we never see that problem as a big problem. Because, for example, if you talk to any policymaker or an engineer, he would say, why I would care about what is going to happen in next 30 years or next 50 years? I would retire from my office, and it would be the responsibility of next person. So I would say that, yes, it is a challenge. We need money to build things, to fix things. But more than that, if we identify the problem right, we would be building right. And it is an opportunity for developing nations, because we are developing our infrastructures. I would say for developed nations, it's a bigger problem, because most of their infrastructure systems has already matured, they are in place, and they are more complacent. We are still designing our systems, and hence we have more opportunity to design better and to build better.
So there's a tip: what America had to do may not be necessary that we have to take the same path. We can
exactly.
have alternate, simpler ways to contain the threat of climate change.
Exactly. And there is something called as frugal innovations, or what we call as Jugaad technology, which has been a buzzword not only in India but also abroad. And many of the Western countries look towards India, that how intelligently and how innovatively many of the people who don't even have good education have designed some of the brilliant solutions to some of the problem. So if we dedicate, identify the problem and dedicate our solutions towards cost-effective solutions, I would say that budgeting and funding will come automatically.
So we need our more local innovative minds. Maybe they are not as qualified, but they have innovation on mind, and they
yes,
can.
And if United States have MITs, we have IITs here, we have NITs here, which have tremendous human intelligence with them. So I would say that we are, if not more, neck to neck with many of the developed nations. Somewhere we are less, somewhere we are more, but opportunities for everybody.
So, and with, we have to be optimist.
Yes.
We may be late, but we are not too late to India. And if I read about American newspapers, every year, every time there are big hurricanes that cripple American cities. Does this severe weather like droughts and hurricanes have something to do with global warming?
So I would say that a validation of these claims that it has to do with global warming or it has not to do with global warming, scientific community is still trying to link what has already happened with climate change, but with more of the outputs available from climate models, which are mathematical models that represent state of the atmosphere and try to solve some mathematical equations for next 100 years, you can see that intensity, duration and frequency of intense hurricanes are expected to increase in warming world, because warm water serves as engine that drives these hurricanes. However, till now, there is less confidence that whatever intensification has happened is because of climate change or not. Similarly, with extreme precipitation events, it's expected that intensity, duration and frequency of intense precipitation storm extremes will rise in future. And similarly, the regions that are wet will get more wetter, regions that are dry will get more drier, and there is like medium to high confidence in all these theories and hypotheses by the scientific community.
In India, we have a lot of anti-science philosophies that counter scientific fraternity.
Mm-hmm.
Is such a problem existing in America also, that whatever scientists say, some groups say that no, this is not possible, this is all absurd?
Oh, absolutely. So if you look at United States, it was one of the hottest debate during last elections, that a group believes that climate change is there, so we have to do something about that, and another political party is of exactly opposite ideology, and they say that climate change is not a real, and all these natural
and
disasters.
Maybe it is industry driven, and they want
exactly,
to promote
exactly, and they want industry to grow as they are growing.
Yeah.
So I would say that their feeling is in fact much stronger. But one thing that we have to take care in mind, in India, we have other issues that we care about first. For example, when we talk about food security, our first concern is that
yes.
we have to provide food to everybody. So
exactly.
our policymakers do not pay much attention that what is going to happen in changing climate.
Yeah,
but this
big,
is the right
it's
time.
It's a big
actually.
Challenge for 2050. The world
yes.
is going to face hunger once again.
Yes,
is,
exactly.
Yeah.
So if we start managing all those things in a better way, keeping in mind the future, are the best solutions could be interrelated. If you solve a food security for next 50 years, 100 years in a sustainable way, you are in one sense also helping to mitigate and adapt to changing climate.
So are the environmentalists world over working on a common platform in I would say that in tune with each other, like a tandem to everyone?
I would say that scientific community also has its agreements and disagreements. So there are climate change believers who say that climate change is real. There are climate change disbelievers who say that climate change is nothing, there is nothing like climate change, it's a natural cycle. I would say both of these stands are there in scientific community and they are equally dangerous. However, as a scientist, you have to be a climate skeptic, that neither you believe nor
okay.
you disbelieve.
Yes.
All you believe is the data-driven results that you get, hypothesis, research that you are doing, and whatever output you get, you treat that output as a credible output. So there is a divide in scientific community,
yeah.
which should not be there,
yeah.
and most of the facts should be based on the experimental exercises that you are doing.
That's a good point. The area of this benefit of doubt should go to the society.
Exactly.
If they are skeptic, then it should be looked into, probed into, and...
Yeah. Absolutely, yes.
Thank you so much for joining in this scientific conversation.
Thank you.